Good afternoon, dear viewers. You are welcome to the CEC Gurukul live lecture. So today I will be presenting my lecture on cell structure and function. I am Dr. Amit Bhattacharya, assistant professor at Department of Zoology, Ramjas College, University of Delhi. So in my lecture, I will be first talking about the structural hierarchy of the cell structures, how exactly the cells are functioning over here, and then subsequently we will move into the functional part of the cell, how the various functions are taking place. Now, all of us know about the ecosystem, how exactly in an ecosystem the various producers, consumers are playing an important part and role in this ecosystem. Similarly, a cell structure is an amalgamation of a number of combinations. Now, if we see the functional genomics, it starts with the molecular and subcellular level, then subsequently it goes into the cellular level, tissue level, then organ systems, and subsequently into the organism system. So this is the structural hierarchy of how exactly a cell is structurally from a simpler form is getting into a complex form. Now, if we see the diagrammatic representation over here, this diagrammatic representation represents the structural hierarchy in the molecular organization of the cell. So the level 1 is composed of the nucleotides, which majorly constitutes the adenine, guanine, thymine and cytosine. Then there are amino acids which are there, then the sugar molecules like the ribose sugar, glucose sugar and the various saccharides. Subsequently, they combine to get into the level 2, which is the macromolecule level. So these nucleotides base pair with one another to form the DNA level. So DNA is nothing but the deoxyribonucleic acid. Subsequently, these amino acid, with the help of the peptide linkages, they form into the protein structures. And while the sugar molecules, they combine to one another to form the cellulose and the various glycogen molecules. Now, the level 3 is composed of the supramolecular complexes, which are further complex part of the level 2. Now, these DNA structures are further coiled and supercoiled into the chromosomal level, while the protein, they get composed into the structural form of the plasma membrane, such as the integral protein or the peripheral protein, or they may form these enzymes in the cell also, while the cellulose and the various sugar molecules, they subsequently form the cell wall over here. Now, all these supramolecular level components, they further combine in a synergistic way and they function in a very coordinated way to form a cell and the various organelles within the cell. So this is how a cell is composed of the various structural hierarchy, which is starting from the macromolecular level to a cellular level, which is the organelles and the cell functioning. Now, over here, I will show you how exactly a DNA, which subsequently it transcribes into a RNA molecule, and from the RNA molecule it gets translated to the protein molecule, and these protein molecules are nothing but they are forming many of the biochemicals or the metabolites, which are functioning in a very important role to do the signal transduction. So the DNA part, the study of the DNA part, is many a times referred as the genomics, and it is said that there are about 20 to 23,000 genes which are present in the human system. Now, the study of the RNA is called as the transcriptomics, while the study of the proteins is called as the proteomics. And while the study of the biochemicals, which are basically the metabolites, is called as the metabolomics. So this is how the structural hierarchy is going into the functioning, and these various studies are going into the interplay. Now, we have just seen the study of the genes is called as the genomics, while the study of the RNA is called as the transcriptomics, study of the proteins is called as the proteomics, while the study of the metabolites, which are functioning in a very important role within the body functioning, is called as the metabolomics. Now, this is a electron microscopy picture of a cell, which is showing the various structural entities present within the cell. Now, if we can see within a cell, there are different organelles which are there, which functions in a very coordinated and a unified manner. So there is a nucleus, there is an endoplasmic reticulum, then there are ribosomes, there are mitochondria, chloroplast is also there, lysosomes are also there. So there are number of cell organelles which are present within a cell. So we'll be taking up all these organelles in the subsequent slides in a much detailed way. Now, the basic entity of the cells is basically present within the nucleus, and these nucleus contains the nucleic acids. So nucleic acids are nothing but the purines and the pyrimidine bases which are linked to one another with the help of the phosphorylated sugars. So a nucleic acid base is linked to the sugar base and it is called as the nucleoside. Now these nucleotides additionally contains one or more phosphate groups. So we can see the structure over here where the various nucleotides are being shown. So adenine is one of the nucleotide, thymine is the one, guanine and the cytosine. These are the four nucleotides which falls under the purines or the pyrimidines the classification, and these forms in a base pairing rule way. Now over here I have shown the base pairing over here. So the guanine base pairs with the cytosine, while the adenine base pairs with the thymine. The guanine is forming three hydrogen bonds over here to base pair with the cytosine, while the adenine is forming two hydrogen bonds with the thymine. Now, there is a complementary base pairing which is taking place within these nucleic acid bases. So, we have just seen how a formation of a hydrogen bond is taking place between the bases of the opposite strand of the DNA. So, a adenine is base pairing with the thymine, a guanine is base pairing with the cytosine. So, over here in this tabular representation, I have shown the DNA contents of the cell within the various organisms. So, we can see over here the DNA content present in the bacterial system, then in the plant system it is shown, then in the animal systems also it is shown over there. So, the haploid DNA content is shown and the number of genes present within these organisms are also shown over here. Now, this is the structure of a DNA molecule. All of us know that the DNA is a double helix structure. So, there are two strands which are running in anti-parallel to each other, and each of these strands are having the nucleotides which are base paired with the complementary bases on the opposite strand. Now, these are connected to one another with the help of the phosphorylated sugar molecules which forms the backbones of these one, and the two bases are interconnected to one another with the help of the hydrogen bond. So, we can see over here the guanine is base pairing with the cytosine with the help of three hydrogen bonds, while the adenine is base pairing with the thymine with the help of the two hydrogen bonds. So, these are forming the fundamental structural details of the cell, and they code for the subsequent level or the functioning of the cells. Now, our body is made up of many kinds of the cell, and each of them is specialized for a specific function. So, each of the cells which are present in our body have been specialized to perform a specialized type of cell. Each of these cell types plays a vital role during the growth, development and day-to-day maintenance of the body functioning. Like the cardiac cell are specialized to perform the activities which are related to the cardiac cell muscles and the cardiac cycles, while subsequently the neurons are specialized to perform the functioning for the nervous system and the signal transmissions over there. So, each of these cell is present with a characteristic function. Now, over here I have shown some of the pictures of the cells which are shown over here. So, these are some of the cells which have been stained in various stains, and they have been shown over here. Now, over the period of time, let's see how exactly in the timeline of the history, how this cell was discovered and what were the various theory or hypothesis which came under the play. Now, in the year 1665, Hooke for the first time identified and named the cell. Subsequently, Leeuwenhoek in the year 1674, he observed the living cells and could see greater details due to the presence of the lenses. Now, in the year 1838 and 1839, two of these scientists, they collaborated to come up with a theory which is given by the Schendon and Schwann. So they noted that the plants are made up of cell. Subsequently, they said that all living things are made up of cells. Now, in the year 1855, subsequently Virchow for the first time proposed that all cells comes from the other cells or the pre-existing cells. Now, this is a microscope or the lenses which was used by the Robert Hooke to discover the first cells. Now, the discovery of the cell is generally credited to Robert Hooke, who was an English microscopist, and at the age of 27, he started looking with the help of these lenses or the microscopes the various types of cells. Now, this is the one of the first diagram which he drew of these cells or the cork cells which he watched under these microscopes. Now, as he wrote in his book in the year 1665, he wrote that I took a clear piece of the cork and with a pen knife sharpened as keen as a razor, I cut a piece of it off and then examined it with a microscope. Me thought that I could perceive it to appear a little porous, much like a honeycomb. So, for the first time, Robert Hooke could make out what exactly a cell looked like, and he can see that the cells of these cork specimens which was used to watch under the microscope, they looked like the honeycomb with a porous cells which is present within them. Now, in the subsequent year, Leeuwenhoek, a Dutchman, he for the first time watched a drop of the pond water under these microscope, and he was amazed to observe the micromolecules or the small microorganisms under these microscopes. So, he said that the microscopic animalcules that darted back and forth before his eyes. So, he was the first to describe the various forms of bacteria which he could obtain from a water in which paper have been soaked and from the scraping of his teeth. So, for the first time he watched the bacterial cells under the microscopes. Now, in the year 1838, Schendon, a German botanist, he concluded that despite differences in the structure of the various tissues and the plants were made of the cell, and the plant embryo arose from a single cell. So, for the first time in the year 1838, he could make out this particular hypothesis. In the year 1839, another zoologist, a colleague of Schendon, Schwann, he for the first time published a comprehensive report on the cellular basis of the animal life. So, this is how the cell theory start coming up into the picture. Now, the observation of the Hooke, Leeuwenhoek, then Schendon, Schwann and Virchow, they subsequently led to the development of the cell theory, and the cell theory is the one which is widely accepted across the globe, and it tells up how exactly a cell and a living thing is performing its day-to-day activities. So, the cell theory basically states that all living cells or the organisms are made up of cells. Second, new cells are created by the old cells dividing into two. Third, the cells are the basic building units of the life. So, this was the basic fundamental of the cell theory which was given by the Schendon and Schwann. Subsequently, the cell theory got into a number of additions also. So, the major classical interpretation of the cell theory was all the living organisms are made up of one or more cells. Cells are the basic unit of life. All these cells, they comes from the pre-existing cells, and then it is said that the cell is a unit of life which can divide and which can physiologically function in a positive way. Now, to the cell theory, there are certain exceptions also which are there. The first exception to the cell theory is the viruses. It is known that the viruses, many of the viruses have been featured as lifeless also because they don't have any cell, or they said that they are not alive. The first cell did not arise from any pre-existing cell, so that's also an exception to the cell theory. Thirdly, the mitochondria and the chloroplast are also exception to this particular theory because they have their own genetic material and they reproduce individually from the rest of the cells. So the mitochondria, chloroplast are an exception. Then comes the first cell which was produced, they were not created from the pre-existing cell, and the third exceptions are the viruses. Now if we see the timeline over here, this is a timeline which is showing how exactly in the various eras, Paleozoic, Cenozoic and the various eras, the various forms of the life and the various structures, eukaryotes, prokaryotes, algal forms developed over a period of time. Now it is said that the first cell, it emerged at least 3.8 billion years ago, approximately 750 million years after the earth was formed. But the scientists were not clear how exactly the life originated and how the first cell came into the picture, because it is said that the primitive environment was a very reducing kind of environment which was having a low content of the oxygen present within them. So various scientists started working on this one and started deciphering out how exactly these creations were created. Now, one of the classical examples or the classical experiment which proved that how exactly in the reducing kind of environment these first cells started developing was the Urey-Miller experiment, which was a chemical experiment that stimulated the conditions thought at the time of the present on the early earth days, and it tested the chemical origin under the primitive condition. So what they did is they created a chamber in which the primitive earth condition was created, which was having a high methane content, low carbon dioxide contents, and the various gases were present. So over there what happened is the water vapors were created, and these through the help of a electric spark they created to form a certain macromolecules which were formed. So number of macromolecules were formed, and it is thought that these macromolecules are the one which was initially created, and they gave rise to subsequent development of the first cell over there. So this was a classical experiment which is shown over here, and the various flasks were developed, and in these flasks the reducing kind of environment was created, and subsequently how exactly these kind of environment it gave rise to the chemical origin of life under the primitive conditions. Now it was also thought that the first life which was created was covered by a phospholipid membranes also. So phospholipid membranes plays a very important role in our cell functioning and cell flexibility. We will take up this topic in a details when we talk about the plasma membrane and its fluid mosaic model and the various models which were hypothesized. Now this is a diagrammatic representation which is showing how from the first cell how the origin takes place of the various organisms and the plant systems, how the cyanobacteria got developed, how the plants got developed, animal kingdoms got developed, archaebacteria got developed over a period of time, and how exactly they diverged from one another to form the different classes or the species of organism over a period of time. Now there are two basic classes of the cells which have been classified. One is called as the prokaryotic system, the other one is called as the eukaryotic system. Now there are certain differences between the prokaryotes and the eukaryotes also. So in the prokaryotes it said that the nucleus is absent, while in the eukaryotes the nucleus is present. The diameter of the prokaryotes and the eukaryotes also varied, while the cytoskeleton is absent in the prokaryotes while it is present in the eukaryotic system. There are cytoplasmic organelles which are absent in the prokaryote but it is present in the eukaryotic system. The DNA content in the eukaryote is much higher than the prokaryotic system, while the chromosomes are generally the chromosomes which are not present in the prokaryote system. The DNA is a single circular kind of DNA structure which is present, but in the eukaryotes, these DNA molecules is coiled onto the histone molecules, and subsequently they are coiled to form the compact structure which are known as the chromosomal structures. Now, the features held in common by the two types of the cell is there is a presence of plasma membrane of similar constitution which is present between both of them. The genetic information which is coded in the prokaryotic and the eukaryotes is basically the DNA system. Then there is transcription and translation processes which are present in both of them, which includes the ribosome in which the translation process takes place. Then there are various metabolic pathways such as the glycolysis and the Krebs cycle or the TCA cycle, which is present in both of them. The major energy currency of the cell is the ATP molecule. While the mechanism of photosynthesis is present, if we compare the cyanobacteria and the green plants, while there are various proteasomes also which are present, which are basically the protein digesting structure or the molecule which are present both in between the archaebacteria and the eukaryotic system. Now, there are many features which are different in both of them, in the prokaryotes and the eukaryote system, which can be classified over here and can be seen over here very clearly, like the absence of the nucleus which is present in the prokaryotes, but it is present in the eukaryotes, while flagella cilia are present basically in the prokaryotic system, but they are not present in the eukaryotic systems. Then there are various specialized organelles which are present in the eukaryotes, which are not present in the prokaryotic system. So there are various differences also between the prokaryote and the eukaryotic system. Now, if we see the diagram over here, this diagram represents the difference between a prokaryotes and the eukaryotes. So, the prokaryote cells, which is shown over here, it's the bacterial system cells in which we can see a single circular DNA which is present over here, which is many times referred as the naked DNA because there is no enclosures which are present or the no nucleus which is present over here. There are flagella which are present, and the pili are also present for the proper locomotions of this one. While subsequently, if we see the eukaryotic cells, basically the protist, fungi, animals and the plant systems, we can see the various organelles which are present, like the nucleus is present, endoplasmic reticulum is present, lysosomes are present, mitochondria is present, in which the various processes like the Krebs cycle, electron transport chain and the various processes takes place. Then there are Golgi complexes which are present, in which the protein sorting takes place. So, the complex forms of all these organelles are present in the eukaryotic systems, which functions in a very coordinated, unified and in a specialized way. Now, these are some of the pictures which are shown over here. These are the light microscopic pictures of the plant cells. So, we can see over here how exactly the eukaryotic systems looks like. So, we can see the plasma membrane which is covering each of the cell, which is distinguishing each of the cell from one another. Then there are presence of the various specialized systems which are present in each of them. Now, these are the some of the stained slides of the animal cells. So, we can see the animal cells, how exactly the specialization is taking place and how exactly each of these cells from the various parts of or the organs of the body, they are different from one another because they are performing this various specialized functioning over a period of time. Now, if we see the cell membrane is a protective covering that acts as a barrier between the inner and the outer environment of a cell. So, over here if we see the cell membrane is a lipid bilayer. So, there are two layers which are present. So, there is a head and tail which is present on the bottom side also we can see a head and the tail. So, there is a lipid bilayer which is there. And in between them, there are various proteins which are present, such as the integral proteins which are present. Then there are peripheral proteins which are present, globular proteins are present. Then there are glycoproteins, glycolipids which are present, cholesterols are present. So, the cell membrane helps the cell to protect itself, and subsequently the various channel proteins help the cell to transfer the various solutes or the ion molecules across its membrane. So there are various functioning which are taking place with the help of the cell membrane. So the plasma membrane is made up of various components. So the first component is the phospholipid, which is basically the basic fabric of the membrane. Then there are cholesterols which are present, which are tucked between the hydrophobic tails of the membrane phospholipids. Then there are integral proteins and the peripheral proteins. So integral proteins are basically which are embedded across the phospholipid bilayer, while the peripheral proteins are either present on the inner or the outer surface of the phospholipid bilayer. Then there are carbohydrates which are present, which forms the glycoproteins and the glycolipids. So these are the various components of the plasma membrane, which plays an important role in the fluidity and subsequent flexibility of the plasma membrane. Now, over here, if we see the structure of the plasma membrane, so we can see the various lipid bilayers which are present over here, and the glycolipids and the glycoproteins which can be seen over here, which are connecting one to the other cells. So many they are acting as the connector molecules or transmission molecules between the two cells. Then there are presence of various transporter proteins across the membranes which are present, which are transporting the ions from one part of the cell to the other part. So they can be uniport, symport, or the antiport kind of transmission which can take place within these transporter molecules. Now, the cell membrane is primarily composed of the proteins and the lipids, while the lipids help to give the membrane their flexibility, while the protein monitors and mentors the cell's climate, and it helps or the assist in the transfer of the molecules across the membrane. So, both the presence of the proteins and the lipids plays an important role in the functioning of the cell membrane. Now, if we see the evolution of the metabolism, so metabolism plays a very important role, in especially in the eukaryotic cells. So the first energy generating reactions, which is presumed to have been formed in the eukaryotic cells, is basically the glycolysis which have been formed out. So over here, if we see how exactly the proteins, fats, and the carbohydrates are broken down into the various simpler molecules. An important component of the cell are the enzymes, which are many a times referred as the catalysis of the biological system. So, enzymes, most of the enzymes, except few of the exceptions, are made up of proteins. Now, one of the most important or the characteristic feature of the enzymes is its catalytic power and the specificity. So, within the enzymes, there are specific pockets or the sites in which the catalysis or the functioning takes place, which are many a times referred as the active sites. So, nearly all the enzymes are protein, except few of the examples like the ribozymes. Now, the enzymes are basically made up of the protein molecule. So, we can see over here, there is a polypeptide chain, which is made up of various amino acids, and now they are coiled in a unique three-dimensional structure, and some of these amino acids fall into the pockets, which forms the enzyme active sites. Now, the enzyme active sites are the regions or the restricted regions of the enzymes to which the substrate binds, and subsequently the products are formed from these enzyme substrate complexes. So, these are basically the pockets or the grooves in the protein surfaces. So, one or many enzyme amino acids can fall under this enzyme active site. So, this is one of the diagram which I have shown over here. So, we can see the enzyme active site into which the yellow colored substrate is bound over here, and subsequently the enzyme substrate which confers into a product, and the product will be released from the enzyme to free the enzyme for the subsequent processes. Now, all these enzymes and the various biological activities within the cells are through the various biomolecules present within the cell. So, now let's take up some of the important biomolecules of the cell. So, one of the first important biomolecules of the cell are the proteins, which are basically made up of the amino acids. So, there are various amino acids which are present over here, and if you see the general structure of an amino acid, so there is a central carbon. To this central carbon, there is an amino group on one end, and there is a carboxylic group on the other end, and there is a R group which can vary from the amino acid to amino acid. So, two of the amino acid, now they combine to one another to form a peptide bond, and in this process the water molecules is released over here. Now, these are the 20 proteogenic amino acids which are present in the biological systems. So, these amino acids have been classified into various forms. Some of them are charged, some of them are polar, non-polar, hydrophobic, hydrophilic. So, based on the R group, they have been classified into the various forms or the various structures. Now, the next important biomolecule of the cell are the carbohydrates, many a times referred as the saccharides. So, these carbohydrates are basically made up of carbon, hydrogen and the oxygen molecule. So, there can be a monosaccharide which is only one sugar which is present over, example is glucose molecule. Then there can be disaccharide where two sugar molecules combines to one another with the help of the glycosidic bonds, and subsequently the trisaccharide and the polysaccharides can be formed over here. So, they are often referred as the sugar molecules. Now, over here, if we see the picture over here, these are representing the monosaccharides. So, the glucose, fructose and the galactose can be seen over here, which are the monosaccharide. Subsequently, there is a presence of the disaccharides in which two of the sugar molecules, they are combined to one another with the help of the glycosidic bonds. So, over here, if we see, there is a sucrose molecule which have been shown, which is a disaccharide of glucose and a fructose molecule. Then the lactose is shown over here, which is a disaccharide of galactose and the glucose molecule. Subsequently, these disaccharides can further combine with one another to form the polysaccharide chain and the glycogen chain, which is a one of the major storage molecule within our cellular system, is shown over here. Now, over here, if we see how exactly the disaccharides are formed over here, so the glucose and the fructose, they are combining to one another to form the sugar molecule, and in the process there is a release of the water molecule. Subsequently, the two of the glucose, they are combining to one another to form the maltose, then the galactose and the glucose are combining to form the lactose molecule. Now, the structure of the polysaccharides are basically, polysaccharides are the macromolecules which contain hundreds and thousands of the simple sugars such as the glucose, galactose, fructose in a combined form. So, glycogen, starch and cellulose are basically the polysaccharides which are present in the various eukaryotic system. So, they are joined to one another with the help of the 1,4 glycosidic bonds, in which the alpha 1 carbon of one of the sugar, it combines with the alpha 4 carbon of the other sugar molecule to form the alpha 1,4 glycosidic linkages. Now, the third important biomolecule of the cell are basically called as the lipids over here. So, various lipids can be seen over here, the cholesterol, triglycerides, triglycerides can be seen over here. So, the fatty acids are basically the long hydrocarbon chains which terminate with a carboxylic group. So, these are basically the C18, C20, C16 carbon chains which terminates with a carboxylic group at one of the end. So, one of the most important saturated fatty acids are basically the palmitate and the stearic or the stearate acid. Oleate is a unsaturated 18 carbon fatty acid chain, which can be seen. Now, over here we can see the C16 fatty acid, which is the palmitic acid. Then we can see the stearic acid and the oleic acid. So, we can see there is a backbone, which is basically the glycerol backbone, onto which there are certain fatty acid chains which are attached. So, to the glycerol backbone, if there are two fatty acid chains which are attached, it is called as the diglyceride. If there are three fatty acid chain, it is called as triglyceride. Like this way, the classification goes on. So, within a cell, apart from these biomolecules, there are various organelles which are also present, such as the Golgi molecule, the nucleus, cell membrane, lysosomes, and the cytoskeleton structures, mitochondria. So, we will come into some of the important organelles one by one. Now, this is a organelle structure and the function of the eukaryotic system, which can we see over here. So, over here, the cross section of a cell has been shown over here, in which there is a presence of a nucleus in which the various chromosomes and the DNA molecules are present in a compact structure, which are then attached to the histone molecules, histone octamers specifically. Now, to the nucleus, there is an attachment of the endoplasmic reticulum, then comes the Golgi complexes, subsequently the lysosomes, mitochondria and the various complexes which are present over here. Now, we have just discussed about the plasma membrane, how the phospholipid membrane is formed over here. This is the model system which is called as the fluid mosaic system. This was the model which was devised and given up by two of the scientists, Singer and Nicholson, in the year 1972. It describes how a cell membrane acts as a two-dimensional liquid structure which is having a high fluidity. It restricts the lateral diffusion of the membrane components across the membrane. So, the membrane components can only move through the channels which are embedded within these particular cell membrane systems. Now, the next important component which is present over here are called as the nucleus or the nucleolus. So, nucleus is an organelle which is present, which is containing the all the chromosomes or the genetic materials present within them. So, the DNA, it is coiled onto the histone octamer and further subsequently it is coiled to form a compact structure which are called as the histones, while the nucleolus are the regions which are called as the nucleolar organizer regions, which contains the genes specifically for the rRNAs or the ribosomal RNAs, which subsequently forms the ribosomes. Now, the next important structures which are present are called as the rough endoplasmic reticulums, which plays a very important role in the transport, or many a times they are referred as the intracellular highway. So, they are specifically the sites of the protein synthesis where the protein synthesis takes place. Now, what happens is as soon as the DNA is transcribed into the RNA, these RNA gets attached to the protein molecules which are present on the top of these ribosomes, which are referred as the rough endoplasmic reticulum. Now, as the proteins are formed from these mRNAs, which are the messenger RNA, the protein formed through the translation process, it gets into the endoplasmic reticulum. So, there is a signal hypothesis which have been given up by the Blobel, how exactly the protein gets into the endoplasmic reticulum and how exactly the sorting takes place. Now, the next important organelle present within the cell is called as the Golgi complexes. So, the Golgi complexes plays a very important role which checks, modifies and packages the proteins within the cell. So, we can see these Golgi complexes over here. So, there are two major phases of the Golgi complexes. One is called as the cis phase, the other one is called as the trans phases. Now, how exactly the protein sorting takes place, we'll see over here. So, this is a diagrammatic representation which shows how, with the help of the endoplasmic reticulum and the Golgi, the protein sorting is taking place. So, we can see over here in the endoplasmic reticulum, there are ribosomes which are present. So, with the help of the ribosomes, the messenger RNA translates into the protein. Now, these proteins are then bleped out with the help of the vesicles and they move into the Golgi complexes. So, in the Golgi complexes, they get attached onto the surface of the Golgi complexes, and depending upon which particular area they have to move on, the protein sorting takes place. Now, some of the proteins, it forms the enzyme, so they remains within the cell. Some of the proteins forms the intracellular channels over here, so they are exported onto the surface of the cells. Some of them form the receptor molecules, so they again are transported onto the membrane of the cells. So, this is how exactly the protein sorting is taking place with the help of the endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi and the various vesicles, which plays a very important role in the transportation of these protein molecules. Now, this is a representation, diagrammatic representation of the mitochondrial DNA and the chloroplast DNA, how exactly the mitochondrial DNA and the chloroplast DNA have been formed. So, there is a hypothesis for these particular thing which is called as the symbiont theory, how exactly they have been attained from the prokaryotic system. Now, These hypothesis is called as the endosymbiotic theory or the symbiogenesis. So it has been said that there is an evolutionary theory of the origin of the eukaryotic cells from the prokaryotic cells. So this particular theory was first articulated in the year 1905 and 1910. So it says that how exactly this particular, the especially the mitochondria and the chloroplast, they came into the existence and have many of the DNA and the other structural entities which are coming up from the prokaryotic organism. So this is showing the complete endosymbiotic theory, how exactly a eukaryotic cell was engulfed and subsequently it became into a mitochondria of the chloroplast cells. Now we come into the one of the important cell functioning of the cell, which is called as the cell cycle. So it is important to know how exactly the cells are maintained and what are the phases of the maintenance of the cell. So the cell generally divide with the help of the process which is called as the mitotic processes, and some of the cells which are the germinal cells, they divide with the process which is called as the meiosis process. So the cell cycle is basically divided into two phases. One is called as the M phase or the mitotic phase, the other one is called as the interphase. Now the interphase have been further divided into three major phases, G1, S and G2 phases, which means gap 1 phase, synthesis phase and the gap 2 phases. So we will come into each of these phases one by one, and subsequently as the cell get prepared for the division from the G2 phase, it goes into the mitotic phase division, where the cell genetic material divides into two halves. Now the interphase can be divided into three subphases, which is G1 phase, S phase and G2 phase, while the mitotic phase is basically made up of mitosis and the cytokinesis, which means that how exactly the cytoplasm is divided into the two daughter cells. Now this is how exactly the mitosis begins after the G1 phase and it ends before the G1 phase. So there is a process of the interphase subsequently going into the mitosis phase. Now the mitosis is basically divided into the various phases, which are called as the prophase, metaphase, anaphase and the telophase. Now in the G1 phase, what happens is the cell prepares itself for the synthesis, which means the DNA will get replicated because two copies of each of the DNA is needed for the daughter cells. So in the G1 phase, the cell gets get into the replication process. In the S phase, the replication takes place. So in the G1 phase, all the enzymes which are necessary for the replication or the synthesis are formed, then the cell moves into the S phase, where the synthesis takes place or the replication of the DNA or the genetic material takes place. While in the G2 phase, what happens is the cell gets prepared for all the enzymes and the other mechanisms which are required for the mitosis or the division of that particular cell. Now the mitosis is further divided into prophase, metaphase, anaphase and the telophases. Now in the prophase, what happens is it is basically the preparatory phase for the division. Then in the metaphase, what happens is all the chromosomes get aligned in the equatorial plane. So if we see from the equatorial plane, they will be aligned in the equator, but if we see from the top position or the polar end, we can see them in the peripheral ring structure. Now in the metaphase, what happens is the cells, the chromosomes get aligned in the equatorial plane, and the spindle fibers which are formed from the centrioles comes and binds to these particular metaphase chromosomes at the point of attachment, which is called as the centromeres. So at the centromeric position, there are specialized protein molecule, protein trilamellar structures which are formed, which are called as the kinetochores also, which are plays a very important role in the attachment of the spindle fibers to the centromere. Now as the spindle fibers get attached to the metacentric chromosomes, what happens is now it moves into the second phase of the division, which is basically the anaphase. So what happens is the non-sister chromatid are then pulled to the opposite poles by the shortening of the spindle fibers. So now what happens is the spindle fibers start getting shortened up. So each of the non-sister chromatid start moving into the opposite poles. Now if we see the first diagrammatic representation, it is showing the representation how exactly all the chromosomes are attached in the equatorial plane. Then subsequently we can see the next phase, which is called as the anaphase, in which how the non-sister chromatid, they are moving towards the opposite poles. So the division has taken place, and then comes the last phase, which is called as the telophase, in which two of the cell gets divided into two daughter cells, each having one copy number of that particular genetic material. So if we see the above pictures, these are the pictures which are showing the live stained slides of the animal cell system, how exactly the mitosis takes place within them. Now, these are some of the pictures which are showing stained with the GIMSA stain. So we can see within that particular slide the metaphase chromosomes, which are aligned in the equatorial plane, very classical example of the metaphase plate. Then we can see in the anaphase, where the two non-sister chromatids, they get pulled up towards the opposite pole and they start moving towards the opposite pole. So the anaphase can be seen over here, and then subsequently the other phases. So this is a mitosis picture which is shown over here with the help of the stained slides, in which the various phases are shown over here, and the how exactly the division takes place within the plant cells also. Now, the next important process which takes place in these systems are called as the meiosis, especially in the germinal cells or the germ cells. So, in the meiosis, a division of the nucleus that reduces the chromosome number by half. So, the meiosis, the chromosome number is reduced by half, and it is a very important process for the sexual reproduction, because the sperm and the egg cells need to have the half number of the copy number of the chromosomes, because when they fuse to one another, they form a 2-1 or the haploid set of chromosomes. Now, it involves the combining the genetic information of one parent with that of the other parent to produce genetically different individuals. So, meiosis plays a very important role in the evolution process also. So, all of us know about the terms, the diploid and the haploids. The diploid are basically the two sets of the chromosome, which is 2N. So, in the humans, the diploid chromosome number is 23 pairs, or we can say it 46 total numbers. So, two of them are the sex chromosomes, while the haploid is one set of the chromosome, which is N copy numbers. So, gametes and the sex cells in the humans are haploid. So, there are 23 chromosomes. So, there are the autosomes, and there is a sex chromosomes, which is one sex chromosome, which is present in the haploid copy number. Now, there is another term which is there, which is called as the synapses. Synapses is basically the pairing of the homologous chromosome to form a tetrad, then the crossing over, in which the chromatid from the tetrad exchange part takes place. So, we will see all these examples in the meiosis when we take up with the help of the diagrammatic representation. Now, over here, if we see the various stages of the meiosis is shown over here. So, if we see in the meiosis, there are 2N copy number, which is present in the first point, then subsequently in the first division, NN copy number gets divided into each of the daughter cells, and then in the next phase of the division, the N copy number retains into all the daughter cells. So, this is how exactly the division, the equational and the reductional division, is taking place in the meiosis process. Now, over here, the meiosis are generally divided into two phases. One is called as the meiosis 1, the other one is called as the meiosis 2. So, the meiosis 1, it is basically having the interphase, prophase 1, metaphase 1, anaphase 1, and the telophase 1. So, if we see the diagrammatic representation over here, the prophase 1 is basically the phase which is preparing the cell or the germ cells to get into the meiotic process. So, over here, the diploid copy number is present over here. Now, all these homologous chromosomes get aligned in the equatorial plane in the metaphase 1. So, in the metaphase 1, we can see all the homologous chromosome aligned in the equatorial plane. Subsequently, the spindle fibers comes from the centriole, and they get attached to these homologous chromosome at a point of attachment, which is called as the centromere, again with the help of the kinetochore complexes. Now, subsequently, each of these homologous chromosomes, they depart from each other and they start moving towards the opposite pole. So, that starts with the anaphase 1. Now, in the, after the anaphase 1, each of the daughter cells are having n and n copy number of the chromosome. So, we started with 2n. In the first division or the meiosis 1, we ended with n and n copy number in each of the daughter cells. Subsequently, what starts with is the meiosis 2, which again start taking place with the prophase 2, then metaphase 2, anaphase 2, and subsequently the telophase 2 and the cytokinesis. So, in the prophase 2, again the cell gets prepared for the next phase of the division. So, in the metaphase 2, each of these chromosomes start getting aligned in the equatorial plane. Again, the spindle fibers comes and get attached to the centromeric positions in the chromosomes. And in the anaphase 2, each of these non-sister chromatid, they start moving towards the opposite poles. Now, in the next phase, which is called as the telophase 2, the divisions takes place and how exactly the daughter cells are formed over here. So, in the meiosis, it takes place a very important role in the reproduction and how exactly the process takes place over here. So, in this particular part of the lecture, we discussed about the various cell organelles, how exactly the cell organelles plays a very important role in the functioning of that one. And then subsequently, we took out how exactly the protein sorting takes place with the help of the endoplasmic reticulum and the Golgi complexes. Then from the protein sorting, how exactly these proteins, they go into the subsequent phases of the processes in which the receptor proteins are, then they are transferred onto the cell membrane surfaces, then the enzymes, they are retained within the cells, and subsequently these proteins plays a very important role in maintaining and proper functioning of these cells. And then subsequently we went into the two major types of divisions which takes place within the cell. One is called as the mitosis, the other one is called as the meiotic phases, and how exactly in the mitosis the various divisions are taking place, the prophase, metaphase, anaphase and the telophase. And subsequently then we went into the meiosis 2, how exactly in the meiosis 2 the different two phases are going for the division. Then there is a, in the meiosis 1 there is a process which is called as the synapse crossing over, which is taking place, which is forming the recombinants over here. And then in the meiosis 1, how exactly the division is taking place, the reductional division is taking place. And in the meiosis 2, how exactly the equational division is taking place. And it is very important to maintain the copy number of these chromosomes, so that each of the sex chromosomes or the gametes which are formed are having a single copy number of that particular within them. So, in this part of the lecture, I end with this particular note over here. Thank you very much.